LDOs are linear regulators and therefore their efficiency is lower than switching regulators. To get the most out of your LDO application, the LDO power dissipation needs to be carefully considered. So let's examine LDO power dissipation in more detail.
When choosing an LDO, the maximum LDO input voltage range and LDO current capability are important factors to consider. But larger currents or larger voltage drop across the LDO quickly leads to higher device power dissipation. This plot shows the relation between LDO power dissipation, LDO voltage drop, and LDO current. When power dissipation increases, the LDO package needs to be able to handle this power dissipation. The power dissipation in the LDO is determined by the voltage drop across the LDO multiplied by the current passing through the LDO. This power is dissipated in the LDO pass element, which heats the silicon die. But how much power can you actually dissipate in the LDO? This depends on IC package, the PCB layout, and the ambient temperature. Let's look at some examples. Here is a drawing of the small SOT23 package in a normal layout. When you look inside the package, you can see that the center pin is connected to the die mounting lead frame. The silicon die is mounted underneath this center pin lead frame. When the silicon die is becoming hot, this heat will be transferred to several parts of the package. Some heat goes through the plastic directly to the ambient. Some heat goes through the pins to the PCB copper and then to the ambient. Due to the thin bonding wires, the outer pins do not have a good thermal connection with the silicon die, and their heat transfer to the PCB is limited. The center ground pin has a good thermal connection to the silicon die, so more heat is transferred via this pin. To improve the cooling capabilities of this package, it is important to add some extra copper to the pins, especially the center ground pin. With improved layout, more power can be dissipated without overheating the silicon die. Here is a different IC package, the popular SOP8 package with exposed pad. In this package, the silicon die is mounted on a separate copper pad, which has an exposed surface at the bottom of the package. In the PCB layout, this exposed pad should always be connected to a copper area underneath the IC. When the die gets hot, some heat will flow through the plastic package and some heat will flow through the pins. However, the majority of heat will flow through the exposed pad, provided there is enough PCB copper connected to it. It is therefore important to connect sufficient copper to the exposed pad to allow more heat flow via this route. When you use a multi-layer PCB, you can add several vias under the exposed pad, which can connect to the PCB inner layers. These will act as effective heat sinks and allow you to dissipate more power in this package. So how much power can you dissipate in each package? You can calculate the allowed power dissipation by dividing the allowed temperature difference between junction and ambient by the thermal resistance between junction and ambient. The thermal resistance value theta junction ambient is shown in the datasheet, but keep in mind that this value is based on the JDAC method, which can be a bit conservative. Here are some practical power dissipation limits for various package types. Based on a normal PCB layout with some extra copper connected to the package pins and thermal pad, a maximum PCB ambient temperature of 60 degrees Celsius, and a maximum silicon die temperature of 125 degrees Celsius. If your ambient temperature is lower, the power dissipation can be higher. If your PCB is small or there are other hot components nearby, the maximum power dissipation may be less.
I hope you now have a better understanding about the power dissipation and thermal conditions of LDOs. For more information on Richtek LDOs, please click the link at the left side or visit the Richtek website at www.richtek.com.